Good morning, everybody, friends. We have minor technical problems because normally you should see what I can see here on the monitor, but I think this will soon be resolved as we have very experienced technicians here. Actually, this is great about the conference anyway, that they have this nice presentation equipment, and it's always a bit humiliating standing in front of this large screen and this large audience. But still, no presentation. I could do it without pictures. This is not my. Actually, I like the colors. So. Grayscale is working as well. I can slowly start, maybe, that we don't lose that much time. So, today, my name is Stefan Richter. I'm the founder of Freiheit.com Technologies. And I founded the company, actually, in 1998. So it's almost 20 years ago. And I just wanted to write code every day. This was actually the reason why I founded the company. I never planned how big it would get, or if after 20 years I still have the same company, or maybe not the same because it changed so many times over these years. This is actually what I want to talk about. How did we change from day zero now to almost 20 years later? What happened in between? And as you might know, there happened a lot of things at that time. When we started, it was in the middle of the internet bubble. At that time, nobody knew actually it was a bubble, but soon after we started, the internet bubble burst. Actually, we didn't want to implement internet software, we just wanted to write software that runs in a browser, which was very revolutionary at that time. Nobody was actually doing that. And I came from this background of my... We're getting closer. That's the background of my laptop. As I said, at that time, we didn't want to build internet software anyway. We wanted just to build a software that runs in a browser, because at that time, Microsoft Windows was dominating everything. And when you wrote software for Windows and you were installing it on 100 PCs, it wouldn't run on 50, even though everybody was convincing you that the PCs are actually completely the same, and they didn't work. And so I hated that very much as a software developer, and I thought it would be very great to run software in a browser, and then I can write my software that runs on the server side. There I can run Unix servers, which were not that popular at that time, so we started with Linux and becoming also very active in the free software movement with this. And we are still sponsoring a lot of things behind this, and also fight against software patents and all this, so it's part of our culture. What have we learned in all these years? So since 1998, where I took on the first day, 1st of October, I went into my office. I actually put on a suit at that time for the first day. And then in 1999, February, we founded the incorporation, and also other people were coming that I already knew, and we built the first team together. So how was time then? So this was actually our first office. So the office was actually our living room and our dinner room at home. So we worked for quite some time there. And actually, at that time, we had no network then at home. We used diskettes, and we moved code around like that. And at that time, version management, you also had SCSS or RCS. There was no Git, there was no Subversion. There was the beginning of CVS, so we used CVS in the beginning. But so this was actually how it looked when we got our first real office. It was 111 square meters, and we already built it very modular. We built the tables that you could move them around, and we, after I think half a year, or I don't know, the first 9 months actually I worked alone. But then from that on, in 1999, we come to a team of about 5 people. And so you can still see the stuff, these gray things with these dark screens. These are actually monitors. Maybe you don't know this anymore. They look completely different today. And there's also an old iMac where we did some web design stuff. And in the in the where the books are, you can still see books about Dreamweaver, which was a tool to build HTML stuff and things like that. So of course we built HTML by hand, but when you wanted to do some graphic stuff, then you needed to have something like this. So it was fun times actually. And so this was then 6 months later, we grew and we had to get a bigger office. And so one of the most important things when you start a company, of course, I think the first thing you need is the problem that you normally have when you run a company is when you're the first guy who's running the company, the next you hire is doubling your costs. And the next two people that you hire, doubling your costs again. And when you have four people, you're very likely to need an office. So this will, again, double your cost, maybe because also office space is not that cheap in the beginning. And so maybe you end up with a small office, and when you're growing, you have to move to another one, which costs extra money. So this is why I think it's very difficult for most companies to get over 10 people, because in the beginning, you're always continuously doubling your costs. So this was also one of the things where we took the decision to get a much, much bigger office. It was four times the size of the for the other office. This has now around 400 square meters. This is in West End Village, the place where InnoGames now is located. And this was really nice loft place. And yeah, this was actually the next evolution step for us to build our teams and grow faster. So you can see, this is on the left-hand side, this is Claudia, my business partner. So also very important when you run a company, it's very good to have like a complementary function, like people taking care for business, especially software developers. I do it. I like programming. I would also do it for free, actually, because I like it so much. But it's very good when you have people who will prevent you doing that. So this is also one part of becoming successful, is having people who know how to do contracts and make money. Actually, you see me in a suit there a little bit. I normally don't wear suits, but at that time it was very normal to go to our customers wearing suits because they were used to that. And now today, even when I'm invited to board meetings at large corporations, I ask them, should I wear a suit? And I say, no, just come like you are. It's great, because I think technical people need to look like this today. So this is the team of the first five engineers. Actually, we were a very tight group, and you see Sebastian, who's still in our company, the guy in the front who looks like very tired. He's now the head of our site reliability engineering team. And we worked so hard in the beginning, like really day and night. It was really, I'm not kidding, it was very, very hard. But I have the best memory of the hardest times. We worked the hardest overnight and everything. And after a very big project, we thought we'd do something good to ourselves. Let's fly to a conference to the US. But we were like so tired, because we worked day and night and all weekends, we were very, very exhausted. So we flew to Denver, Colorado, which is located 1,800 meters over sea level. And then the conference was in Keystone, which is around 3,500 meters over sea level. So what this means, when you're completely exhausted, you fly in there, you're totally tired, jet-lagged, and then you have to climb a stair of five steps, and we were barely able to make it. We had to grab the rail to just get up the stairs. And so this was like even adding on our exhaustion, but it was a nice conference anyway. But this is also memories that we have, and this is the only group picture from that time. So at that time, we were like five people, we were working all the time, we were programming, and we also had the thing, we wanted to organize our work, but we were pretty sure, and this was actually the starting hypothesis that I had when I started the company, that the way how software development is done is completely wrong. So I was like just over 30, I had 10 years of experience as a programmer, mostly programming C. And I have seen so many things, like having project managers that decide things that they don't understand, promise stuff to customers. I have seen all that. And I was pretty sure this is wrong. But the whole industry was doing that. So I was a little bit like, can this be that I only see it? No, normally everybody should see it. This is wrong how this is done. And so I said, we will do it completely different. We will have no managers ever. We don't need managers. We can do it much better than them. For us, as programmers, it's much easier to understand what the customer needs and what he wants, and then just write the program for it. So I think this is a better way. And this is how we started. We said we will never need managers. We do everything ourselves. So this is why we from the beginning, we were always like a real engineering organization, so focusing everything on engineering and make this the primary focus to make the work for engineers better and easier and try to have minimum administration, minimum bureaucracy, doing everything in a very simple way. And so we invented even our own agile method before this really existed as a thing. And I even wrote a book about it, 2003, which was one of the worst ideas I had ever had. Like writing a book, 2003, we were like also constantly all the time. And in my spare time, I was writing a book. So it was like, and you're never happy with it. You don't want to publish it because there's so much work to make it better. But in the end, I did it with Edison Wesley, and it was called Feature-Based Programming. And it was also a little bit like very comparable to Scrum. And today we are working more Scrum, Kanban style, but most of the principles from that time is still the same what we are doing now. So today it's completely different. We have a very large office in St. Pauli. We have around 100 people. We have very modern offices. You have seen the old style. At that time, we thought our offices look really neat and very, you know, slick. Because we always said an office has to be better than an average flat. Because people should love to go to the office, because also we love to work with people together. It's also why I founded the company, being together with other programmers. So I'm a little bit different than maybe today. Everybody wants to work remote and from their home, and I'm still this old-fashioned guy who really loved to talk to people, sit together with them. So we always took very much effort in building great office spaces, making it nice, and this is also one of the things my wife and business partner Claudia is doing. And so here you can see a team in a team meeting in one of the meeting boxes that we have. Here is also a retrospective from one team, and yeah, people having, you can have as many monitors as you want to have. Thorsten is also one of the guys who's like over 15 years with us in the company. Yeah, Katrin is one of our product directors and engineering directors. She's a very tough girl. She's very, very good in understanding problems and presenting interesting, simple solutions for customers, customer problems. So all of our customers really love her. Here's a team working on the Metro project, one of the sponsors here. We're working on the large digital transformation initiatives for them. So this is my wife. Actually, I had to take the picture because you've seen the old picture of her. So, and here you see people doing a daily meeting in the morning. So, and these are two of the Go masters that work in our company. You can go to our booth and play Go against Rasmus, who's a 3 dan. And on the right-hand side is Benjamin, I think, and 5 dan. And he's 10 times in a row second German master, so he never got on the first place, but since 10 years he's always in second place, but he's a really great guy and a great computer scientist. So actually when you start a company, I like to give this talk a little bit from two perspectives, and I try to switch a little bit about this. So one thing is, if you want to start your own company, what should you think about? And on the other hand, I also want to give a little bit of advice for organizations who are maybe now at the point where they want to change themselves and also want to become software companies. So what would you do? Of course, when you now you're programmers, when you start a company, it's very easy. You are the first engineer, and it's much easier to hire other engineers. Yeah, just hire your friends, basically. The people you know who get things done, you know that they do good work. But when you work in a corporation and you don't have any engineers, it's very, very important to get the first engineer being a very, very, very good guy, because he will be the example for everybody else who will be hired to this company, and he will set the tone and the style of work and also the level of quality and knowledge. So you have to get a very, very good first engineer in your company or in your organization. So, but again, when we started in 1999, founding the incorporation, I actually hired friends, people I worked with, so it was very, very easy. And then we had our first job application posting in Linux Magazine, and it was like in very big letters, "We don't want people who use compilers." And then in small caps, it was like that they cannot write themselves. So, and we got really, really good applications from people being interested in stuff like this. And we had one guy, and we liked him so much, we hired him. But in the end, it turned out he wasn't really a good programmer. He actually wasn't very suited for it in the end. Today, he isn't also a programmer anymore. So we thought about, oh, what did we do wrong? And of course, when you hire people, you don't want to get rid of them. So everybody was friendly to him. But actually, nobody wanted to work with him because he wasn't getting anything done. So everybody was very polite and everything, but I saw that something was wrong. And so we thought about our hiring practices and changing that. And so when we defined then some kind of tests, how can we measure how good people are? And there's lots of discussion also today about coding interviews and brain teasers and everything, you know, from Microsoft and Google. And most stuff is really, really too complicated. So what we are trying to do today is having very, very simple problems, and we try to take away everything from you, so you will not use difficult languages or programming constructs. So you will only try to solve it in a simple way. We just want a simple solution from you with the least amount of stuff that you have to do for it, to just see if you can like build a solution without having anything at your hands. But at that time, when we tried this out the first time, we were very afraid. Are we doing this right? And so we had one guy coming in, Markus, a really great guy. He worked then after that over 8 years, or I think almost 10 years for us. And he's now living in Berlin. And we interviewed him for straight 8 hours. So it was really like we had changing teams and everybody had like checklists, what can I ask him? And people were like taking notes and I thought like, maybe this is a little bit too much. And after 8 hours, he was also very exhausted, but then we drank a beer together in the kitchen. And actually, I think this is also one of his favorite lifetime experiences that we had, or that he had. So today we improved on that. After that, I did hundreds of interviews with engineers and physics people and mathematics. So today we mostly have computer science, physics and mathematics people. And after a couple of years, I started training other engineers to do this and to learn from my experiences what works and what works not, and what is the focus in CVs that you should look at. And of course, I always challenge that this is not like a rule-based system. You have strict rules and everything must fit. We also try to look for outliers very much, see new things that we didn't see coming before. And today, all the interviews are actually done by engineers. So we have a recruiting committee. Every day, we have another team on duty. So when you send us an email with an application, we will definitely answer it on the same day. Most of the time, like always in 24 hours, when you do something, you will get a reply back normally on the same day. And so for each day, we have a team doing that. And so from the beginning, you only have contacts with engineers. So we never had an HR department, and because everything was running by engineers. And we only had from our office team, they were organizing meetings or people organizing tickets that people flew into to our office. So this was actually the way we built it up. And today, I think when people apply for us, then most of the time they have their first meeting in our company before they even have an answer from other companies. So this is, I tell this now, this is a very big competitive advantage how we're doing it, but we don't care. We would do the next thing even better if we change our process. So, and this is actually what we introduced, and we introduced also a new applicant tracking system called Lever, which is a Silicon Valley software, but also Google is also bringing something now to the market called Google Hire. Maybe we will switch to that in the future. But we also worked for quite some time very well with Google Docs folders, with like a process steps where just folders of people were like drag and drop to other states. So it was working very well. But today we have like about 15 people involved in hiring and doing all the interviews. Interviews are then coding challenges that you're doing online. If this is good, you come in, do a coding challenge on the blackboard. When this works well, you do a pair programming with one of the guys to see how to solve problems together and also get to know each other better. So this is how we are doing hiring now. And it's very, very cool to see how also people get involved from your own company hiring the new people in the end. So. But then again, when you have an organization like this and you start hiring engineers and you hire friends, it's very easy. People know why they want to work with you. It's because of friendship. But why should people that they don't know you work for you? And so maybe you have seen presentations like start with why and everything, but this is actually really the point. Why are you doing it? Why are you founding a company? Why are you building software? And this, I really advise you to really think about it, why you're doing it, because also in the future, it gives you more purpose for your own life. So for example, when I started the company, I really just wanted to write code. This was my favorite thing. And I was sitting together with the guys in a bar, and I said, let's do it like this. We write the greatest software that we can do. We have only the people we like. And guess what? We even make money with it. So people will pay us for it. I was like totally excited about this idea. But then when we had our first customer doing Travel Channel, which was a travel business before Expedia, we were building flight booking engine for them, for example, and a hotel and all the different products before this existed on the market. We got to know the people so well that actually we were doing it for them because they were becoming our friends. So our purpose was really not just building software, making money with it, which was actually never the case why we started this. It was actually friendship. So everybody was friends with the people at Travel Channel. And actually, they also had a very good organization of people. One was an expert for flight bookings, one for hotel. So they were already product owners. And we had one engineer for each of these experts. So we were already working a little bit like everybody likes to work today. And we had like a value-oriented approach with them. So the business manager said, I need to have this functionality for 50,000 marks at that time. Can you do it? And then we try to find out how to build something for that amount of money, because otherwise, if it's more expensive, it's no use for them. So, and this is how we worked for, I think for almost 10 years, we worked for Travel Channel, maintaining the code base for almost 10 years. Today, this is like a commodity business. You can buy stuff off the shelf. You don't need to individually write stuff. But this was really something, friendship. And today, for example, when working with Metro, why should you work for Metro? Or we work for Daimler and we build connected car stuff. Or why should you work for them? They're big corporations. Why do you work for them? Actually, today our purpose is really to help our customers to really be successful in technical, in digital transformation. Because this is so important for our country and for our area here, for whole Europe, that we are able to not just destroy jobs and ship them abroad, but really create new jobs here. And the large industries like car manufacturers, it's over 800,000 people working in this area. We really have we really have to be good to really fix the problem that they have. They are very good in building mechanical things, but they are not very good in building software. And so this is very important for us to work with them and build the future of car manufacturing in Germany. And in Europe especially, because we all know when people lose jobs, what happens? And you can see this in the US, in the big Rust Belt, people have no jobs and then they hire people in the government which maybe don't belong there. So, and also with Metro, it was interesting when we took over this this job. It was an interesting lineup of different teams coming in, briefing us on the different systems we would have to connect. But then there was one guy really standing out at the Metro team, and this was Aleš Drabek. He's now the head of disruption at Konrad Electronics. He's doing the internet stuff there. He's a great guy. A nuclear physics PhD and really smart guy. And he really fired me on. It was like he told me about the small businesses that are the customers of Metro worldwide, like mom and pop stores working 18 hours per day, having small hotels or restaurants. And so he really knew the purpose why we were doing it. It was really why the system that we are building for online food delivery is to help small businesses to be successful and have a sustained family business. And so if you run your own organization or if you run your own company, try to think about what your mission is and what your purpose is. And for us today, it's like really being an example for our customers and teach them everything that we know to become successful and learn from the mistakes and from the successes that we have had in the past. But then when you hire engineers, the next big problem is onboarding people, especially when you grow fast. Maybe if you have seen presentations from Netflix or Uber, I think on the GoTo conferences, I think they grew from 200 people to 2,000 engineers in about 1.5 years. How are they doing that? Actually, one of our guys migrated to Canada, a programmer, and he's now working for Amazon in Ontario. And he said, like, their teams are created all the every day. Like, every day people are shifted around in teams, and they are focused around small microservices. So they have like hundreds and hundreds of services and hundreds of teams working together on big, large fan-out architectures. And so how do you grow like this? How do you add new people and bring them together without losing your culture? And this was also very important for us. In the beginning, it was very, very easy. It was like you had friends. It was easy to hire people, put them in a team. We only grew by 3 to 5 people per year. It was very, very good. But of course, it was always like, we just gave you your computer and so start working, and if you need help, just call me. And then you proved yourself, more or less. But then in 2006, 2008, we grew way too fast. We almost doubled our company for all these 3 years. And this was actually way too fast. And we had also large new projects that we had to staff. So this was really a big problem for us, because we had actually no management structure at all to handle all this. And we also had no onboarding, and we also didn't have the feeling that we needed it, because onboarding was never a problem, right? It worked. So at that time, we saw a very, very big cultural shift, because the new people were not really integrated, and the existing people, most of them were almost 7 years working for us, was already a tight group, and they also got connected somehow. But the new groups were more or less creating their own version of the company, the way they thought the company was meant to be. Actually, they were excited to work with us. They saw they were excited to start with us. They have heard about our reputation, everything. But if you don't explain what kind of direction you want to take and what is really your thought and your purpose behind it, it's very difficult to get everybody on the same page. And we were not getting behind this fast enough. So it took quite a while to really fix that, I think almost 3 years to really settle that, also get rid of people, because if people are there 1 or 2 years and you were not really able to integrate them culturally, you can only lose them. It's not possible to really integrate most of the people. So it took a lot of time for us, but we learned huge things about scaling and creating new teams. Actually, in Silicon Valley, the large corporations like Google started in the same year as us, and they are way bigger than us. How did they do that? Actually, they have so many people having experience in this area that all these founders get advice from senior people, and they're building an onboarding organization from the beginning. So today, our onboarding is very, very different. So we have a very, very a strong focus on bringing new people into the teams, doing pair programming with them, and we also have a new onboarding way of doing is like you get a very, very good, perfect briefing for a story that you implement. You will have a mentor. People will do task breakdowns with you, design decisions, explain the code, do pair programming if you want it, or if people think you should have pair programming for specific things. And you will have mentor support. And then after delivery of your first story, there will be a meeting where it's like bi-directional feedback, what was good, what was bad, what is the training that you need. We also, before you start, you get training for all the technologies that are used in that team, because on the level that we are working now, we have teams of 3 to 5 people, but we have larger projects with many, many more people. We put these teams together, and now I lost track because I saw the 5 minutes sign. We built this team together, and we also built our own training organization to train all the important technologies that you get what we call escape velocity, so that you at least able to handle the stuff that is there in the project by yourself, and then give you more guidance while you're working on the stories. So this is very important, and also bringing you into the various activities that we do as a company to also bring people socially together. Because when you have small teams, they're not connected to everybody in the company, and we have to make sure that everybody knows and gets along with each other. So I think one of the most interesting things then in the end is when you have an organization, you know your stuff, you know how stuff works, you know your technology, but how do you learn something completely new? So when we started 20 years ago, almost 20 years ago, we started with Java 1.01. So that was the version at that time. And so there, Today we are doing Go, we have Clojure, we have even a Haskell service running somewhere. We did common Lisp systems for customers doing machine learning stuff. We do TensorFlow, Python, so all these things. But how did we get there while we were working at it? So we always try to do the things today to see changes, tectonic changes in technology, and try to pick up things first. But normally, most of the time, it was always more or less me coming with new things to the teams. And then, of course, there were also random people doing that. But if you don't want to randomize this, if you want to do this structured and bring new technologies, you have to find out how to do that. And we tried several things. We had like pet projects, so you could apply with a pet project and get time for it and do it. But this didn't work. Then we did code jams. Like, we had some idea, people can come in, code together. It was nice, but it actually didn't work. It didn't bring anything new. And we have hacker talks, so every Friday people present the work that they did, which was very, very well now, so it's very, very received. But it didn't work really to bring new technology in the company without relying on single people. And so today what we have is factions. So factions are groups, expert groups, about the most important things that we have to tackle for the future all the time. So one thing is data science and machine learning. So we already started 5 years ago hiring people with machine learning backgrounds. So we have a quite good machine learning team. And we have agile methods and principles to get more effective all the time. We have a big group test engineering to make tests better, because also with microservices and canaries, testing also changes very much. Then we have architecture and technologies, and this is also a way where we manage a tech radar of the technologies that we want to bring in. And if somebody has an idea, they come to the tech faction and we create an experiment to try things out. Then we have augmented reality and virtual reality. Actually, some of my colleagues started a project. They were taking photos. Actually, Eric was doing that, taking pictures of a statue. Statue, is this the right word for it? I don't know. Modeling a 3D thing of it. And so I thought we should funnel this energy in something useful for the company. That's why we created the augmented reality and virtual reality faction, taking care of the future of human and machine interfaces. And what's completely new now is UI UX faction, which is very important to get more closer to design things, and SRE. So we also already started, I think, 2-3 years ago, building up a site reliability engineering team, as we have seen that in cloud operations, you don't have administrators. Classical operators don't know how to do that. So there must be a new breed of people doing that, a new job description. And we started building up an SRE team and also help our customers today do it. So these factions work on these things, and they also generate trainings and trainers. So these people become trainers to train our people in our company with the experience that they gained in the projects. So it's first-hand knowledge. It's not like something you learned from a blog post. And all the factions here have their own mission that we have. Like architecture and technologies is create simple architectures and systems that are easy to understand, extend, test, deploy, operate, and maintain. And our machine learning faction has the mission to make AI part of everyday's job for everybody of us, because we deeply believe that AI and machine learning is something that every software engineer has to do in the future. So, but when you have all this organization, you come to a point where you see the single engineer. How can you empower the engineers? When you read blog posts, most people say like, oh, let the engineers figure this out themselves. They already know what to do. And this is only partially true. So to be effective, you have to work on the right things. This is what effectiveness means, working on the right things. Because you are all knowledge workers. Every day when you sit on your computer, you're taking very important decisions about things. And these important things, how do you decide them? What guidance do you have to decide which is right and which is wrong? And this is really important for a company to give the direction and the goals that you want to achieve. So make it easier for the people that have to take decisions on a minute base to do this in the right direction, to take the right decision. And to be effective, you have to make sure that people understand what the direction is. I read an article about the Marine Corps. I couldn't find it actually, but I'm sure I've read it. It's that officers in the Marine Corps learn what the people 2 ranks above them need to know when they are working. So And this is an interesting concept because everything looks completely different once you run an organization. If you run a team, it's completely different than being a programmer. If you run a group of teams, it's completely different. And if you run a company, like I do today with my wife, it's completely different as well. So this is the most important thing to, if you go into engineering management, to learn that you also have to learn new perspectives and also how to be effective in this new perspective. And so, for you, as knowledge workers, we try to train everybody to be able to build the complete product alone. So we want from idea to operations, we train people to build the whole things themselves. So killing the whole buffalo, you know, like this. And this is, of course, a huge task when you come from university. You think you have figured out software engineering and you think you're a great programmer. But after maybe half a year, you see that there's so much stuff to learn. And but we try to help you with that and help you grow into this role step by step and have also a process with trainings and feedback and peer reviews to make you more effective in everything. And the final thing then is when you're able to also introduce new technologies to be effective on the engineering level, how can you as a company change yourself? Like I said, 20 years we had two big global crisis where we went through, we always were at positive cash flow, we always made money, because we always took the right decisions. We were always thinking what is next and how to get there. We always doing that. So how to do that? Actually, in the beginning, it was like Claudia and me and the key people in our company were talking about things and getting in the direction. And like in the beginning, it was very easy. You jump on the table and say, now we go in this direction. Everybody's like, yes, we do it, and then we go. But with 100 people, you cannot do this anymore. So what are we doing now is we call this the theory of two superpowers. So a theory of two superpowers mean you today every company and even every person needs to have two superpowers. So one thing is the knowledge you have, like you're a programmer, you write programs and you do this very well, this is your superpower one. But superpower two is actually how to change yourself, how to learn new things, and also how to unlearn things that you already know. This is the most challenging thing for people who know stuff since 30 years and now have to change everything that they know, which is a problem for digital transformation. People don't want to do this because they're afraid of doing this. So, but this is the two superpowers that every organization, every person need to have. And what we are doing, we are creating objectives for the whole company, and then all the teams, all the people can create key results add to this mission and that to these goals that we have. And everybody in the team can set their own goals and they even score their own goals. So, and this is actually called OKRs, maybe you have heard this before, objectives and key results. We already did this 5 years ago, which didn't work that well. You have to do a lot of things to really integrate it in your normal work day, that it's part of your normal life, changing yourself, having goals, working on goals that are different from the goals of our customers. But now we restarted this initiative this year, and it worked very, very well and is very well received, and people are really trying to be part of moving the company forward and doing it very well. And what we add to this is a North Star metric for the whole company. So one very, very simple metric where we can see we are moving in the right direction. And for example, YouTube has the measure of view time. So they try to increase the view time of everything. Everybody's working on that. And at Facebook, everybody's working on daily active users. So how many daily active users do you have? So this is one very, very simple measurement, and you have to do a lot of things very, very good to make this work, and this is how we keep focusing on changing ourselves. This is an example for OKRs, how to score them, but I skip that to allow also for some questions maybe. Last thing, things I did not talk about, and I had a podcast with some people called Our Way to New Work. Maybe you should look it up. It's a very interesting format that they make. And the interviewer asked me, oh, you founded the company you always wanted to work in. What did you do first? Did you buy like a kicker table or whatever? And I said like, no, this is actually not what I wanted to have. The most important thing for me was to do something interesting and work with cool people. And so I didn't talk about perks like massage, kicker tables, free food, or flexible work hours, or working from home, or high salaries, or nice office spaces, or great parties, or great culture, whatever. We have all this. This is not the problem. But these are all only extras. If you're not able to do something that makes people better, and also every single person in the company can grow, not only the engineers, we also have non-engineers, then it's no use. It's not that fun that much. And it doesn't help then to have a kicker table and free food. So we wanted just to make a great place to learn and work. And I think this is actually what is also nice about the future of work, that if you want to get good people and retain good people, you actually have to do this. The larger you are, the more important it will become for you. So, and on the other hand, what can I give you as engineers as an advice and from my own experience? When you want to be successful in the future and learn new things, it only does work when you work hard. So it's always hard work. It's never coming by itself. You always have to focus on making yourself better and working hard on this, because this all the remote work that is happening now will also create competition, a global competition with programmers sitting in Papua New Guinea or maybe Kuala Lumpur, and you're competing with them in the future. So you have to make sure that your knowledge is good, that you're progressing, and that you learn in the fastest pace possible. And this is also what we strive as a company. If we want to be successful in the future and people will buy our services in 10 years from now, we still have to be top-notch and best in everything that we do. So this is why we care for people, do things right, and make work fun by having challenging tasks that are a little bit more difficult from the level that you are already. Make it a little bit more difficult, because work is only fun when you are challenged a little bit. If it's always below that, it gets boring, but it shouldn't be always way above what you can do. Then it's also bad. And we try to maintain this very well, to make work fun and challenging for everybody. So it's also one of my jobs. Okay, so that's actually my talk about the last 20 years, and so maybe we have some questions that I can answer. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions? Over there. So before that, I have one question.
Yeah.
In complicated systems and in traditional companies, often the founders have a goal like, I want to have a company with 20 or 100 or 200 employees. You talked a lot about learning, but you don't talk about a target in that measurement. Did you ever had that?
Like a measurement, how much people learn?
No, how many people should your company have?
Oh, no, we never had a target like that. It's actually, we always said, actually, we don't want to grow. We want to stay small, and we only add people if we need them. But the interesting thing is, we have to grow to make new things. Because normally when companies work with us, they like the work, like to work with us, and they stick with us. So normally companies don't go away. And so if we want to do new things, we have to hire people and also bring the people that work in existing projects into new projects to make it also more interesting for them.
So growing is a result of learning in your company.
Yeah, that's the thing.
Okay. So the question over there.
At some point you mentioned that in the history of your company, you changed your onboarding process by having pair programming sessions with new employees, so probably your senior developers were sitting down together with the new ones, teaching them and showing them how things work. Did you notice a drop in productivity during this time? And if yes, how did you cope with it?
Actually, it was not exactly this way. We did not really started then introducing pair programming. People were doing this like from day one. So we were introducing people. The thing that we changed was making the process of onboarding more reproducible. So and in the first couple of years, it was more like it depends where you went, and the onboarding process was different. I think it was always good. Always people were helping each other, and so. But we want to make it reproducible and making sure that it's the perfect onboarding that we can do, the best we can do. And this is actually what we introduced. So I couldn't see any drop in productivity or whatever, because we were not changing the way actually the people, the engineers are doing.
So thank you, Stefan. Thank you to the audience. If you have further questions, I guess you are here for the next 2 days. Thank you a lot.
Thank you very much.